गढ़वाल की पौंडीचेरी और पंजाब जैसे विश्वविद्यालयों में आपको ये गौरव प्राप्त रहा है और आप बहुत सेंटर की चेयरपर्सन ही नहीं है, आप आज भी उन्नत भारत जैसे महत्वपूर्ण जो संस्थान है उसकी भी आप चेयरपर्सन होने का आपको गौरव प्राप्त है। ये सब चीजें आपने अपने दम पर, अपनी मेहनत पर, अपने काबिलियत पर, संघर्ष में के आधार पर शामिल किया है। मेरा ये सौभाग्य रहा है कि आप आज से 20 वर्ष पहले एक नेशनल सेमिनार और उतना ही नहीं आपके स्वजन से जो परिस्थितियां स्थिति हमको मिली उस कुन दुबे जैसे फॉरेन सेक्रेटरी से रूबरू होने का और मार्गदर्शन का मुझको मौका मिला और राजनीति विज्ञान की निष्ठा चंद्रकाल पाड़िया से भी मेरा वही संपर्क हुआ था। मैं बहुत आभारी हूँ और मैं न केवल मैं और न केवल मिथिला विश्वविद्यालय अपितु हिंदुस्तान में आज जो परिस्थिति बनी है विदेश नीति के बारे में जो बातें कही जाती रही है उस पर मैं कुछ कहना नहीं चाहूंगा क्योंकि आप निष्णात विद्वान हैं, आप उपस्थित हैं, लेकिन इतना तो तय है कि विदेश नीति की जो रक्षा है, देश की जो प्रतिष्ठा है, देश का जो स्वाभिमान है संबंधित है और मूलतः ये माना जाता रहा है कि उसमें कोई बहुत बड़ा परिवर्तन नहीं होता है लेकिन परिवर्तन साफ दिखाई पड़ रहा है। सॉफ्ट स्टेट की जो चादर थी उसको हटा करके लगता है एक सुदृढ़ ठोस और व्यवहारिक जो विदेश नीति है जिसका आज निस्मक टेस्ट भी एक तरह से होने जा रहा है। ऐसे समय में आप उपस्थित हैं इसका उद्घाटन करने के लिए और हम लोगों को गौरव प्रदान करने के लिए निष्णात राजनीति शास्त्र के प्रोफेसर और हायर एजुकेशन आपने एक फाउंडर वाइस प्रेसिडेंट के रूप में जिस तरह से आगे बढ़ाया है और जिस तरह से गौरव प्रदान किया है 14 से 19 तक आप उसका उसके उपाध्यक्ष भी रहे। जैसा कि मैंने आपको बताया कि ये मेरा सौभाग्य है कि हमको आशीर्वाद देने के लिए इस वेब लेक्चर को उद्घाटित करने के लिए आप यहाँ उपस्थित हैं। मैं आपसे अनुरोध करता हूँ गुरुदेव हाथ जोड़ करके कि आप अपने उद्बोधन से हम लोगों को लाभान्वित करें। डॉक्टर कामेश्वर झा जी जी गुरुदेव प्रणाम।
सर प्रथम मैं ललित नारायण मिथिला विश्वविद्यालय के एलुमनाई के रूप में विदुषी सारस्वत प्रतिभा में एक मानक स्थान ग्रहण करने वाली अन्नपूर्णा नौटियाल जी का अभिनंदन करना चाहूंगा। ये हमारे विश्वविद्यालय के लिए, मेरी मातृ संस्था के लिए गौरव की बात है कि आप इसके भी हाथ में इसके असरात उत्तर राजनीति शास्त्र विभाग और अध्यक्ष डॉक्टर जितेंद्र नारायण जी के आग्रह पर अपना मूल्यवान विचार इस विश्वविद्यालय के माध्यम से सारी दुनिया को भेज रही हैं। वैश्वीकरण के युग में जो आपके विचार सुशासन के संबंध में है, विदेश नीति के संबंध में है, लोक शासन के संबंध में है, उसके बारे में मैं वाकिफ हूँ। आज ये उद्घाटन का अवसर मुझे मिला और राजनीति शासन विभाग ने दिया, इसके टेक्निकल असिस्टेंट कमेटी को भी मैं धन्यवाद देता हूँ और हमारे साथ ही इस विभाग के एक बहुत ही बड़े विद्वान, उन्होंने इंडिया आफ्टर इंदिरा किताब लिखा था और किताब में स्वदेश की बातें उन्होंने खूब जमकर लिखी थी, बहुत अच्छी किताब थी। मैं उनको भी, ये विश्वविद्यालय में अधिकारी भी रह चुके हैं, इन्हें मैं धन्यवाद देना चाहता हूँ। मेरे छोटे भाई हैं और आप उन्हें सुनेंगे ही। मैं यह जरूर कहूंगा कि जब कभी भी मौका लगा है तो मैंने डॉक्टर मुनीश्वर यादव जी को सुनना पसंद किया और आज फिर पुनः उन्हें देखने का सुनने का मौका मिलेगा। अध्यक्ष आज राजनीति शास्त्र विभाग के डॉक्टर जितेंद्र नारायण हैं। यह एक अपने आप में एक अद्भुत बात है कि मिथिला में आज मिथिलांचल, मैं भी जानती होंगी कुलपति महोदया जानती होंगी कि यह विद्यापति की भूमि ही नहीं, भारती और मंडन की भूमि है, जहाँ शंकराचार्य जी को भी थोड़ा सा विचार करना पड़ा था कई सनातन मुद्दों पर। कहते हैं लोग जो हार गए थे भारती से, उस भारती की भूमि में एक दूसरी भारती विदुषी आई है, आज विदेश भारत की विदेश नीति पर चर्चा हो रही है। मैं थोड़ा सा स्पष्ट करना चाहता हूँ कि भारत की विदेश नीति के बारे में हमारा क्या रास्ता होगा आजाद भारत के बाद, इस पर हमारे संविधान निर्माताओं ने सबसे पहले विचार किया और उन्होंने विचार करके राज्य के तीन निर्देशक तत्वों में धारा 51 में यह लिखा कि राष्ट्रीय शांति और सुरक्षा के लिए हमारी भविष्य की सरकारें सतत प्रयत्नशील रहेंगी, यही शब्द उसमें लिखा हुआ। अंतर्राष्ट्रीय शांति और सुरक्षा भारत की भी दुनिया की भी, और भारत ने उसका निर्वाह किया। भारत ने अंतर्राष्ट्रीय शांति का प्रवाह किया, अपनी भी शांति का प्रवाह किया, लेकिन निर्वाह गया, दुनिया दो खेमे में बची थी। हम तो आज के संदर्भ में अभी उद्घाटन करेंगे, दो खेमे में बटी थी, लेकिन हमारे देश ने फैसला किया कि हम क्षमाबाजी में नहीं पड़ेंगे, हम न अमेरिका का पिछड़ू बनेंगे न सोवियत का पिछड़ू बनेंगे, हम जहां कहीं भी दुनिया में स्वतंत्रता पर आंच आएगी, प्रजातंत्र पर खतरा आएगा, कहीं भी अतिक्रमण होगा व्यक्ति आस्था पर, सब दखल देंगे और उसी का साथ देंगे जिसका पक्ष मजबूत होगा। हमने नॉन अलाइनमेंट की पोथी बनाई, शुरू में तो केवल टीटो ने साथ दिया यूगोस्लाविया के और नासिर ने इजिप्ट के नासिर ने साथ दिया, लेकिन बनते बनते हमारी संख्या काफी बड़ी जवाहरलाल नेहरू जी के समय 56 पहुंची, बाद में ये संख्या 77 पहुंची, फिर ये संख्या 103 तक पहुंची। आज दुनिया में दो शक्तियां दो ब्लॉक नहीं है, न शीत युद्ध है, उस शीत युद्ध में भी हमने शालीनता का पालन किया और दुख भोगा। कहते हैं सत्य की विजय होती है, अंततः भारत की विजय होती गई और दुनिया में सबसे बड़ा संकट प्रजातंत्र पर और स्वतंत्रता पर हमारे ही पड़ोस में पूर्वी पाकिस्तान में उत्पन्न हुआ। शेख मुजीबुर रहमान प्रजातंत्र के चुनाव में विजयी हो गए, इसके बावजूद पाकिस्तान के यहया खाने जुल्फिकार अली भुट्टो ने उनको दखल नहीं दिया, भारत ने पहल की और बांग्लादेश आजाद हुआ, हमने सोनार बंगला बना दिया, थोड़ा सा बीच में खटास आया, लेकिन हमारे वर्तमान प्रधानमंत्री ने शेख हसीना से बात करके, सही वार्ता करके, संवाद करके, दोनों देश के हित को देखते हुए उस खटास को मिठास में बदल दिया। नेपाल हमारा पड़ोसी है, हमारे वर्तमान प्रधानमंत्री ने प्रतिनव जो विदेश नीति अपनी बनाई है, उस विदेश नीति को दो शब्दों में करेंगे, ये पॉलिसी है लुक इस पूरब की ओर देखने की।
कुलपति महोदय जो समय का थोड़ा सा है प्रॉब्लम, संक्षेप संक्षेप में सर कंक्लूड किया जाता
है। बस ठीक है, वो अभी लुक ईस्ट की पॉलिसी है और नेबरहुड का कंसेप्ट है जिस पर हमारे प्रधानमंत्री पहल कर रहे हैं, सफलतापूर्वक पहल कर रहे हैं, कठिनाइयां आ रही है लेकिन संवाद की शैली से हमारे देश के अधिकारियों ने उसे हल करने का प्रयास किया। मैं यही कहना चाहूंगा, भारत देश पामर्स्टन की जो पॉलिसी थी कि दुनिया में कोई शाश्वत दोस्त नहीं है न कोई शाश्वत दुश्मन है, कि अपना राष्ट्रहित ही सबसे बड़ा निर्णायक तत्व है, विदेश नीति में भारत ने उसको कभी नहीं माना। भारत ने कुछ मूल्यों के लिए विदेश नीति का पालन किया, जिन मूल्यों की हमने चर्चा की और उस पर हमारे प्रधानमंत्री चल रहे हैं, और फल है कि आज हम सुरक्षा परिषद में पहुंचने की कगार पर हैं। फल है कि जहां चुनाव होता है भारत के प्रतिनिधि विजयी होते हैं और हम लगातार दुनिया में अपना ध्वज फहरा रहे हैं। आशा है आपके भाषण के बाद कुछ और चेतना फैलेगी, आपकी विद्वता का कुछ प्रकाश और फैलेगा और भारत के लोगों का जो चेतना बढ़ेगी उस चेतना से भारत सरकार को भी कुछ और आगे का रास्ता सूझेगा। इस विश्वास के साथ मैं फिर पुनः आप सबों को धन्यवाद देता हूँ, अपनी बातों को समाप्त करता हूँ।
गुरुदेव बहुत बहुत आभार, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, आपने गौरव बढ़ाया और चूंकि समय इसमें सीमित है इसलिए हमको बीच में कहना भी पड़ा जो अच्छा मुझको नहीं लग रहा था, क्षमा करेंगे गुरुदेव। अब मैं सीधे अपने आज के मुख्य अतिथि माननीय हेमनंद,
सभी को नमस्कार, अ वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। एम आई ऑडिबल?
या
यस,
फाइन,
वेरी क्लियर।
प्रोफेसर कामेश्वर झा, द ऑनरेबल फाउंडर वाइस चेयरमैन ऑफ स्टेट हायर एजुकेशन काउंसिल बिहार, ऑर्गेनाइजर ऑफ दिस प्रोग्राम प्रोफेसर जितेंद्र नारायण, हु हैज बीन अ डियर फ्रेंड एज ही ऑल्सो मेंशन्ड इन हिज इंट्रोडक्टरी एड्रेस दैट मोर देन टू डिकेड्स बिफोर वी मेट एंड सिंस देन वी हैव ऑलरेडी मेंटेन्ड दैट कॉन्टैक्ट एंड ही इज डूइंग वेरी एक्सीलेंट वर्क
एट
हिज यूनिवर्सिटी। एंड Professor Munishwar Yadav also, he must be there with you. So I have been asked to speak something on India's foreign policy, and I'm very happy and I'm very thankful to you that you gave me this invite to speak on India's foreign policy, which presently we are seeing that it is in a very crucial juncture. Like Professor Jha said that India is doing fine with its neighborhood first policy. There is no doubt about it, because when we talk about foreign policy, it is about national interest. And national interest is a sum of domestic and international interest. So as per the national interest, India's policy of neighborhood first is a good policy. And out of that policy, during the time of COVID also, India started to help its neighbors and also proposed to fight this pandemic jointly by making a joint force. And India also created a $10 million SAARC emergency fund. India also pledged $2 million to WHO, where the US said that we are not going to give any money to WHO, because the US, under the conspiracy theories, is holding China liable for the spread of COVID or coronavirus. And it is also holding responsible the WHO for siding with China, and that's how it has stopped giving any aid to WHO. So this is a very interesting phenomena which we are witnessing in the field of international relations. On the other hand, India not only provided aid to WHO, but also extended help to provide testing facilities equipment and sanitizers to fight this COVID crisis to Maldives, Sri Lanka, Afghanistan, Nepal, and Bangladesh, India's immediate neighbors. India also pledged to introduce 5 trillion in a meeting of G20 for these kind of activities. New crisis management protocol was also developed for global health issues. Like this is a pandemic which is unprecedented. One pandemic which we have only historical data because it was 100 years before. And presently we don't have anything to know about that pandemic. The same situation was prevailing. There was no vaccination. We don't have still a vaccine for coronavirus. That time also social distancing was practiced. That time also we were under the lockdown conditions, maybe the people who were alive at that time. So the same situation will save us today also. That's how we are meeting virtually. Otherwise we would have met in person. But everyone has become suspicious of the other person, and this suspicion is coming into international relations also. That's how China is the most important suspect country. It has become a suspect country that it hides the information from the international countries about the spread and the magnitude of coronavirus. And when the infection reached in every part of the world, then China claimed that it has controlled the pandemic. And it opened. And then it started to sell its masks, its PPE kits and other equipments to the countries from where it purchased it earlier to fight its pandemic. Even it supplied these PPE kits to India also. But the PPE kits which were supplied were of so low quality that many states refused to use them. So this is the quality of Chinese goods, and this is the quality of the things which today everyone is saying that we have to boycott China. Like 132 countries have created a forum where they are saying that they have to isolate China. So isolation, which was earlier a norm of development, like the United States was isolated from the world affairs for a long period because it thought that economically it has not developed. So up to Second World War, it did not participate in the international relations because of its developmental concerns. But afterwards, when United States thought that now it has become a superpower, then United States participated in international relations, and now it is the only superpower. So isolation was used by the US for its development. But presently, isolation is being used to isolate China because of its various things on which I'll touch upon. Now, on the one hand, India is trying to have an effective global presence through various initiatives, through various issues and various actions. Like India was threatened by the US that if India will not supply hydroxychloroquine to the United States, US will retaliate against India. India did not bother. India did not reply. But India supplied the hydroxychloroquine to the United States, not only to the United States, but to all the neighboring countries and all other countries which demanded it. So India is approaching the international relations with a cooperative approach, with a collaborative approach, and where it wants to connect the people of India with the countries of the world. And there are various things which India is doing, like Make in India, Startup India, Make for India, Swadeshi. These things are not meant for isolation, but these things are meant to make India independent, self-dependent, because self-reliance is a major issue in the present day global world order, where globalization is a norm. And due to globalization, every has become dependent on the one in India. Whenever there is any festival like Deepavali, we have lights from China, we have Ganesh and Lakshmi from China, because they are cheap. So China has used this dumping tactics against India, and that's how the trade surplus, it favors China, not to India. India has a trade deficit. China has a advancement on that front also. So while India wants to collaborate, cooperate, and peacefully resolve the issues, China is not understanding these things. Now China has emerged as a new challenging power. It's a challenger. It is not only challenging India. India is, in comparison to China, is still a middle class power, because China has both powers, soft power and hard power both. Soft power is displayed through its money power, like its debts, which it has been given, it is giving to all of India's neighbors. You name any neighbor, Nepal is totally dependent on China for its economic development. And recently, Nepal has become so much pro-China that it has changed its maps also. And certain part of Indian territories are shown in those maps as Nepalese. And you try to understand the intricacy of this issue. Afterwards, after a while, China will develop infrastructure there, and because it is just in the Indian borders, and that infrastructure will be used against India, like it is being used in Pakistan, like it is being used in other countries. China's policy has very, very certain characteristics. Like, this policy is based on deception, concealment, and surprise. So you can see all these aspects when China talks about India, or when China and India relations are governed. On the one hand, we have various things which we say optics. Like, we talk about a good chemistry between Prime Minister Modi and Xi Jinping. There is a Wuhan summit. There are various summits where Prime Minister Modi and Xi Jinping have met, in the sidelines of the international forums also. But what is happening at the borders? The areas where a shot was never fired since the last so many years. Still, a shot has not fired, but there are casualties on both sides. One CO, commanding officer of Indian side, is dead. And there are several soldiers which are dead and injured. And in Chinese side also the same must have happened. And they fought this with stones, with rods, and with spiked equipments, without firing any bullet, any shot. So the border is tense. So what is China doing? Can we depend on China? और वी हैव टू बी रियलिस्टिक अबाउट दैट दैट चाइना कैन नेवर बी अ फ्रेंड इवन इफ इंडिया वॉन्ट्स इट. लाइक कौटिल्या टोटली टॉक्ड अबाउट दीज थिंग्स दैट देयर कैन बी फोर काइंड ऑफ कंट्रीज एनिमीज फ्रेंड्स मीडिएटर्स एंड न्यूट्रल्स. It's very easy to identify who is enemy. It is very easy to identify who is friend. It is very easy to identify who is mediator. And it is also very easy to identify that who is neutral. We have very clear perception about enemies. And this perception, in present context, we can say that China is India's enemy number one. Whether we have conferences, whether we have meetings, or whether we have many agreements with China, like 1993 agreement on the maintenance of tranquility along the borders. China is never a dependable country. We can never depend on China. And the next thing, which is very important for us to know, as Kautilya also said, enemy's enemy is friend. And this is a realist perception of international relations. So enemy's enemy means Pakistan. Pakistan is also a great friend of China. And they are together in thick and thin. Both have different kind of strategies. Pakistan has a very good strategy of bleeding India, and which it says that 1,000 cuts on India through terrorism, that they will bleed India through terrorism. So they promote terrorism, insurgency, and they want to create a difficult kind of situation for India at the borders. So India is always at the tenterhooks, always at the tenterhooks. Then China. China is a very cunning country. Like I said that there were no bullets fired between India and China since I think 1967. Though nothing happened after that. But China has been doing this repeatedly. There are border incursions. Their troops, they come. They occupy that area. They erect some kind of structures, maybe temporary. Their forces come and there are man-to-man fights and afterwards they go back. Sometimes Indians also go because the LAC, the line of actual control, is not very well defined in many places in Ladakh, Uttarakhand and other parts. So that they take advantage of it. So it has been happening since so many years. But every time the situation was controlled by the higher level dialogues, by the higher level talks. But this time, this situation has not been controlled by the different levels of dialogues. Local commander level, higher level, lieutenant general level. Even I think now the diplomacy will work. And till date, diplomacy has not worked. So China is a cunning country. China never wants India to be considered as equal power in Asia. Because China wants to control the world. China is challenging the United States of America. So how China can tolerate India stepping into its force? So that's how China is doing everything to disturb India. It is not allowing India to peacefully control the COVID situation. It has started the border clashes. And I do not know that how far this will go and how far the tensions would go beyond this. So this is one. So China and Pakistan are clear enemies. And now what is China doing? China is trying through its policies, like I said, that policy. It is trying to befriend every neighbor of India. You talk about, just now I talked about Nepal. Nepal is just sitting in the lap of China. Whereas we always claimed that we had roti beti ka sambandh with Nepal. But Nepal says that no, we are not concerned with this roti beti sambandh. We don't care. We want this territory to be ours. And Nepal, even so much so that Nepal is a landlocked country. Everything goes to Nepal from India because it has a road connection from India. It's a landlocked country. But now what is happening? It is very conveniently, it is tilted in favor of China, and China is constructing a port access for Nepal. Now you see what kind of activities are going on. The roads are being constructed by China. Port is being constructed by China. So Nepal is totally under Chinese influence. That's how it is behaving very awkwardly with India. And Pakistan, as always, if we go back to 1971 war, when the world was divided on the lines of bipolarity, Dr. Kameshwar Jha slightly talked about it, but I just want to bring it for a reference point. That in 1971 war, when Bangladesh was created, there was bipolarity. And there was a triangle between between Pakistan, China, and the US. And this triangle was against India. But at that time, ex-Soviet Union was siding with India. And so, what India's policy? Why this? India gives all help, but it was using a double stick. That stick is soft power, give loans, construct highways, airports, ports, and whatever is required. And then hard diplomacy. If the country does not take back everything and make that country pauper. So these countries are not realizing it because they have anti-India sentiments. Maybe they realize it, but they want to make it a point that we don't like India. So that's how they are being. I think India is the only country which has the guts to say, no, we are not going to be the party of this program, this initiative. Why? Because this PRI is another economic tool of colonization, of making colonies. Because now China is new aggressive power, colonist power, which is making different kind of colony to Africa, to other places by its economic diplomacy. Because when we talk about foreign policy, when we talk about international relations, we also talk about superiority. And this superiority is reflected by two, three things. One is the military power. If you are a militarily great, always a great power. Then the superiority is also reflected by economic power. So presently, the dominance of economic power is giving, I think, added advantage to China. And China is spreading everywhere. Its wings are everywhere and it is leaving its footprint in all parts of the world. It is not like that no country is doing anything or nothing is being done. Like if we talk about India also, India has, like we talked about, Act East policy. Act East policy is definitely to counter Asian reason. Like I said that but now it has become Indo-Pacific. And this term has been coined by the United States of America. Because the US is also apprehensive of the Chinese expansion, Chinese exploitation, and Chinese game. So the US also wants to, US also wants to control China, contain China. Earlier also there was a policy of containment, and that policy was containment of communism during the Cold War. But now, presently this policy is containment of China or controlling its economic expansion or economic empire in different parts of the world, which it is trying to do it. Like we are meeting on Zoom. Zoom is also owned China. So China and everyone is using that. And China is named or branded as a cheater. Data manipulator steals data. It manipulates data. It can do, and that's how the countries are faring, that the coronavirus was also developed in a laboratory and fraud, and every country has been infected. So, US is trying. US is also trying, and India is also trying. Like India is trying to build up relationship with Japan, and that's a strategic partnership. India is trying to get into the close relationship with BIMSTEC countries, and this is for equality, territorial integrity, political independence, non-interference, peaceful coexistence, and mutual benefit. And then there are other partnerships like WAD, that is US, Japan, India coming together. Free, cooperative, collaborative, and rules Indo-Pacific. Not only this, but to tackle Chinese pressures. Chinese pressures, and also to control India's encirclement, which is Hong Kong, or about isolation of China, or like supporting Tibet. It was a punishment policy. But this policy is not going to control China. I think some mic is still unmuted. There is some problem which I am hearing, and this is distracting.
I'm very sorry.
No. You need not to be sorry for that. But just request everyone to mute their mics.
Bol do. Ganesh ji, kindly mute all the mics, please.
Don't
yes, sir.
Mute
my
except Honorable Bhai, sir, kindly mute
please
all the mics.
Don't mute my mic, otherwise how would I speak?
No. Okay. Except so nice of you. Okay. Except Honorable Bhai, sir, rest of the mic must speak.
Yeah, I think it's okay now. There is no disturbance.
Okay. So I'm very sorry.
No, not at all. It happens because we are new to this virtual medium. It happens.
Yeah, okay.
We are new to this virtual medium, we need to know the etiquettes of using it.
Yes.
So it's not your fault, not at all. I'm not holding you guilty. No. It's my pleasure. It's my pleasure, actually. US has also devised policies like the US rebalance to Indo-Pacific was also to control or contain China. And then the American Trans-Pacific Partnership was also meant to counter BRI, Border Road Initiative, Belt and Road Initiative. Earlier it was Silk Route or Maritime Silk Route, but now it is named as one BRI, Belt and Road Initiative. But China is, as I said, that it's very cunning, and diplomacy also allows that countries can be cunning. So this US-Japan's attempt or India's attempt were blocked when China announced that it is developing a Asian Infrastructure Bank. So that was again countered because it provided again money to the countries. So now it's a new kind of Cold War which is happening between a established power and between a rising challenging power. And which is this rising challenging power? This rising challenging power is China. Established power is the US, so it is challenging the United States. And now India is facing a double-edged sword. China, Pakistan is there. As I said, Pakistan uses terrorism because Pakistan feels that India is strong enough to deal with Pakistan. So it uses terrorism. And China is using salami slicing. This phrase has been used by Brahmachalini. He always writes about this, salami slicing. Like it is eating into India's territory slowly and slowly, and which is not recognizable, which is not very specifically recognized. It is eating into India's territory and trying to hold its control, and you can see it throughout the borders because the borders are still not defined. They are still under dispute or like that. So against Pakistan, India launched surgical strikes like Balakot, like Uri, to punish the terrorists. But against China, what should be the strategy? What should be the option? It is yet to be decided. Because dialogues are going on, bullets are not there, but even then casualties are happening. So how to de-escalate this? What should be done? High-level dialogues are going on. So can the chemistry between Prime Minister Modi and Xi Jinping will do something? Or Xi Jinping again to show that it is a very good country, a very good neighbor, will do something. When COVID here is not of the India as it was in 1962, India is not the India of 1962. There are several developments. And the most important development which India has done is the infrastructure building, like roads. It has connected the border areas with the roads. Which China is not like it. Because China thinks that it is the boss. It can develop roads, but not India. Why should India develop the road? China can develop the Karakoram Highway and connect Tibet with POK. And the other important thing which China could not digest and China reacted very badly was that when India declared that there would be three union territories, Ladakh, Jammu and Kashmir. China was the only country to make noise. It was India's internal matter, but China was reacting that how India can do it, because these territories are disputed territories. India says that only POK is the disputed territory, and that dispute is also resolved because India says that it belongs to India. And now the Indian Meteorological Department has started forecasting the weather of POK also. So India is aggressive. India is not the India of 1962. China also knows it. So I think diplomacy will be the best option to control this kind of situation under the current scenario. And this message will, I think it will reach to China somehow, and within, I think, 3-4 days or maybe within a week or 10 days, Xi Jinping will come into its own avatar, and then again there would be some diplomatic parleys and the situation would be resolved. This is my presumption. But at the same time, India is also not showing any kind of weakness in front of the Chinese challenge. This is also good about India's diplomacy. And that's how China is following the tactics of salami slicing, that you acquire certain portion, then you acquire certain portion, which is highly negligible. Slowly, slowly eat it out and then make it your territory. So, India's strategic partnership with US and other countries to counter China, to oppose the BRI, India is taking several steps. Like, India has also started a project that is called Sagarmala. This project is that India has also started a ferry service from Kochi, and it will go up to Zanjibar. So the Sagarmala project is that India will touch different kind of island countries through this project, and it will connect with those countries. And then there is Asia-Africa growth corridor for growing up and also to integrating this area so that the countries which are threatened by the Chinese moves can be controlled or can be contained or can be sided with India and Japan, because Japan is also troubled by China, Vietnam is also troubled, Philippines is also troubled, Malaysia is also troubled. Recently, China also was very hostile towards Philippines. So every country is troubled by Chinese aggression, Chinese behavior, because as I said, China now the main fight is not military, but fight is now maritime through sea, because sea is the main trade route. Now in 2015, there was a Panchshil agreement between India and China, and that was done by Pandit Nehru. Panchshil means there were five principles of conduct which these countries were to follow in their interactions. One was that mutual respect for each other's territorial integrity. We see it in present times, we find that this is totally missing. There is no mutual respect from China about India's territory. Otherwise, why the salami slicing tactics is being used? Number two was mutual non-aggression, that both countries will not adopt aggressive exercises, rather they'll dialogue. So what is happening now? It's not mutual non-aggression, but it is one-sided aggression by China. And then mutual non-interference. This is totally not followed. It is the duty of China to interfere in India's matters, like Dalai Lama has been given shelter in India, and there is a government in Tibet, government of Tibet in exile in Dharamshala. And whenever Dalai Lama visits any part of India, particularly Tawang region of Arunachal Pradesh, there is always opposition from China. Whenever there is a demonstration by Tibetans, there is opposition by China. Even China refuses to provide visa to Indian citizens of Jammu, Kashmir. It gives stapled visa. Why? Because it considers that this territory does not belong to India. It's a disputed territory. In the international forums, it always opposes India. Like India's permanent membership in Security Council or NSG member. So there is the question of non-interference is never there, treated badly. And then there is no question of mutual benefit, which India wants to promote through this Panchamrit. Then Samvad, dialogue, because we always say that dialogue is better than deadlock. We can solve many problems through dialogue, but if there is a deadlock, then the problems are not solved, like what is happening in the border areas between India and China presently. This is because lack of dialogue. Although dialogue is going on, but this dialogue is not so far very fruitful. So, Samvad means engagement. You have to engage with the neighbors, engage with the all powers, engage with the global powers, with the military powers, economic powers, for the fulfillment of your national interests. Then Samriddhi. Samriddhi means prosperity, and this prosperity should be shared. Because if one country is poor, other countries are very rich, then also a divide is created. And that divide is known as haves and have-nots. And this will not allow peaceful atmosphere in the world. So Samriddhi, prosperity should be shared. If one country is prosperous, then it should try to promote other countries also to follow the lead. But which is not happening. because China wants to maintain its economic power, and so much so China is going to the countries who are very good friend of US, like Israel for that matter. China is building a port in Tel Aviv. Israel is a very, very important country, which is very friendly to the US in the Middle East. But China has penetrated there also. And it is building a port there in Tel Aviv. So what China can do? It is not shared prosperity, but it is monopolizing prosperity. It wants to monopolize it. It wants to maintain it for itself only. Then the another Panchamrit is Suraksha. And this Suraksha means security. And security has to be linked. Domestic security, first we have to be secure domestically. Once we are secure domestically,